random rivers. Today I am going to discuss about the natural resources and natural resources in context with other water resources. So first of all, we will discuss what is a resource. A resource is any form of energy or a matter which is essential for the functioning of an organism or an ecosystem. Basically, without natural resources, the humankind will not exist. Maybe it the biotic resources like from the plants, animals, or abiotic resources. Maybe abiotic resources such as minerals, petroleum, natural gas, coal, and or any other resource. So natural resources are classified on various criteria. If we classify the natural resources based on origin, they we categorize it as biotic and abiotic resources. So biotic resources, as the term itself defines, which is derived from biological origin. So like plant resources, animal resources like forests, microorganisms, which can be brought into the use. And abiotic resources are those which are not originated from the organic material or biological resource like minerals, petroleum, and other resources. So based on stage of development, the natural resources are classified as potential resource, actual resource, reserve, and stock resource. Potential resource are those resources which have been surveyed and can be brought into use in near future. And actual resources are those resources that are presently used. And reserve resources are those resources on which survey is done and they can be used in far future. They are reserved basically for the future generation. Stock resources are these resources are also surveyed, but they cannot be used because lack of technology. And based on availability, natural resources can be categorized as renewable and non-renewable resource, as the definition itself, as a word itself, explains the based on their renewability, time period taken by resource. So we will be discussing about renewable and non-renewable resources. So renewable resource is that basically gets renewed within a short span of time, like solar energy, wind energy, geothermal energy. Basically, they are never exhausting resource. They are infinite, and they get renewed within a short period of span, within a short span of time, basically, which a human being can imagine. And non-renewable energy resources are those uses that take millions of years, that is out of scope of the human imagination. So the resources in non-renewable category are the coal, natural gas, and petroleum resources. So what are the differences of what are the differences between renewable and non-renewable resources? So if we take a renewable resource which is more sustainable, it puts less pressure on the ecosystem or on the environment, but demand is but the technology for using these resources are not so much developed. So the demand nowadays for these resources is growing as the human population is growing because other sources of energy are getting really scarce. So they put less strain on the limited supply of fossil fuel, which are considered as non-renewable resources. And using renewable resources on a large scale are costly. more research is needed to make such resources more acceptable in the society. In context with the non-renewable resources, they are very cheap resource. They are less expensive. Every human being is able to use such resources like petrol in your cars, diesel, coal, natural gas, LPG we use in our home. They are all non-renewable resources, but these resources are not sustainable. Now we will move to water resources. Water resource is one of the renewable resource, but with a limited use. If we use the water resource unjudiciously, it will be not available. So what are the sources of water? Surface water, groundwater, desalination, and frozen water. Surface water is mainly the water which is available in the form of rivers, lakes, streams. And groundwater is in the form of springs, aquifers that comes up. Or we can use the groundwater as borewell. Desalination is the very costly method in which the sea water or ocean water is desalinated, and the fresh water is regenerated from that. And frozen water is the water which is frozen in the form of ice or glaciers. So, why is water so much important to the humankind? As we know, the water is considered as a desire of life. No life can exist without the water. Even even we are finding the water on new planets, if we find the water in there, definitely we will find a life. So there are some properties of water which makes it so important for the biological organisms. It has anomalous expansion behavior. When we see the water is freezing, it expands. Like in winters or water bodies, they form an ice layer on the surface so that their temperature below that ice will be constant, so that the aquatic fauna and flora will be safe. This expansion behavior also important in the oceans. So it has high specific heat. So it takes much of the water energy per unit volume to heat up the water, that it stores the heat, and that is very important in the climatic processes and weather processes. Like oceans in the daytime take much of the heat and releases that heat slowly in the at the night. If you see in the deserts, it gets very cold at night because the heat loss is very fast. Sand loses its heat very fast, but the water in the ocean temperature is constant because the water slowly heats and slowly releases the heat and keeps the temperature almost constant during night. So it has high latent heat of vaporization. It takes really large heat, really large amount of energy to get vaporized. So it has high surface tension and cohesion. Surface tension is very important. If we talk about the salt water and fresh water, they didn't mix because of the surface tension. Cohesion is important when water gets transferred from the roots to the hundreds of feet of the top of the tree. That is because of the cohesion. That is a property of water, that it gets from the ground to the top of the tree because of the cohesion. So what is the budget of the earth or the water? So if we see about 96.5% of the water is salt that is available in the oceans, and only 0.9% is in the other saline bodies like salt lakes, saline water bodies or brackish water. So only 2.5% of total water on Earth is the fresh water. Out of this 2.5%, 68.7% is locked in the glacier and ice caps, and only about 1.2% of this water is available in the surface of fresh water. Surface water is like our rivers, streams, lakes. That is only 1.2% of the 2.5% of fresh water, total fresh water on the Earth. And the groundwater, which is about 13.1% of this fresh water. Out of 1.2% of the fresh or surface water, 69% is in ground ice and permafrost. In lakes, it is going to be around 21%. In atmosphere, is 3%, and other living organisms less than. In rivers, you can imagine it's only 0.49% of total surface water in rivers. And now from that, you can imagine how much water is available with us. But this water is not uniformly distributed over the Earth. Some locations are very less amount of water, some locations have very high amount of water, like or Kashmir is surrounded with lots of glaciers we have in this river system, and the water availability is very high. So if we are not getting the water 24/7 at our homes, that is not because of the water availability, that is a problem of infrastructure, the water supply crisis basically. So now we will go to the sectoral demand of the water. If we see from the chart, from 2010 to 2015, from 2010 they have just extrapolated the graph how much the water demand will increase, in which we can see around 70 to 80% of the water is used in the agriculture, and it's still increasing. And in drinking water, it is almost constant. And in energy production, the water demand is increasing. So in India, if we see this, 80% of the water goes to the agriculture, and 22%, around 15 to 20% goes to the domestic or drinking water. The rest of the water goes for the industries. So means there is a lot of scope of water saving or water conservation in India. So that was the water demand. Water availability is drastically decreasing from 1951. And it has been extrapolated, it will still decrease, and it will make India water scarce or water stress country. It's only because there are many reasons why is the water, fresh water availability decreasing over the period of time. From this chart we can see water scarcity is just because of the supply problem. If you will not get the water 24/7, reservoirs, water is available in the reservoirs, and it has no infrastructure to be available at your home. That is water scarcity. Water stress, when there is a deficiency in an ecosystem, there is a water deficiency in the ecosystem. That is called the water stress, and these water stress will lead to the water risk to our businesses. Like many industries, they need water, so they the water risk will increase. So for water risk, there are many reasons, maybe because of the bad governance also, and or due to the basin condition. Basin condition means from where the water is coming to the particular place. For example, if the people are going migrating to a location which has not much carrying capacity for sustaining the population. They have no resources, but there is a pressure. There is a consumption from the population to the resources that leads to water risk. For many businesses, or the water supply will run out for domestic supply. So, water stress can be of many reasons. First of all, as we know, is the population growth. So, by next 2050, another 3.5 billion people will be added. So, resources are limited, water is limited. Same amount of water was available in 1951 and same amount of water is available now, but only the number of people who are adding to the world. So obviously the per amount per capita of water available will be decreasing, so every person will need water, and that will lead to the water stress. Another reason is business activity and urbanization. You know, or most of the factories like our power plants, NHPC, National Hydro Power Projects, or another industries like Coca-Cola or other industries that need much of water. So that all water comes from our surface water or groundwater. So that leads to water stress. So then there is a trend of increasing urbanization. Cities are building, new cities are coming every year. So people are coming, living there, their living standards are increasing. So water availability, water demand is increasing. So there is water crisis. So another important factor is climate change or depletion of aquifer or groundwater. So if we say the climate change, basically climate change increases due to climate change, there is an increase in temperature, there is irregularities in the weather conditions, like there is more rains than snow. So if the snow is less and rains are more, the water is not conserved in the form of ice or in the form of snow, so that it can be slowly available over the stress period. So when the temperature increases, that water will be available only in one season, and in next season, in summer season, where water is more needed by the people or by the industries, it is not available in such quantities so that they can run their businesses. And also, our agriculture and other industries, they are taking the groundwater very extensive way, like in the states of Punjab and Haryana. Water, groundwater has been exhausted and it is not available in the borehole up to 400 feet. So because of the Green Revolution, most of the water was taken from the groundwater, and the electricity was available on the flat rates. So there were many reasons why there is a depletion of aquifers. So in a location where there is no surface water or less surface water, and there is a depletion of groundwater, naturally it will lead to the water stress. So now we see what are the various methods for the water conservation. So it can be at the source level or the consumption level or even at the transmission level. First of all, when drain water is coming, we should try to decrease the runoff losses. If we see in the urban areas, most of the structures are concrete, so there is less chance of rainwater to get percolated or to get into the soil, so that the groundwater is recharged or it is saved for the next season. So we should try to decrease the runoff losses. We should try to reduce evaporation losses. Evaporation losses are mainly material in the agriculture, if we are growing the crops, we should do the mulching so that the evaporation losses from the soil are less, and we have to apply less amount of water for irrigation. So storing water in the soil, what I was saying that if we do the practices like rainwater harvesting, we can store water in the soil in the form of tanks underground that can be used for next season for irrigation or even for feeding the cattle, reducing irrigation losses. Irrigation loss, most of the agriculture in India is employed or they are performing the surface irrigation. So only up to a plot needs only up to 0.1% of around 0.1% of the total water, the surface water is used, and the rest of the water goes waste in the form of evaporation. So we should reduce the irrigation losses by using the micro irrigation technologies like sprinkler irrigation or drip irrigation. Reuse the water. Reuse the water is, for example, in our domestic, in our kitchen, we can save the water that can be used for irrigation or in flushing our toilets, and our water from the gray water from the kitchen. Waste water is called the green water, and black water is called water from the toilets. That can be separately used or separately saved for the use in irrigation or growing or kitchen gardens. Preventing wastage of water. The wastage of water is in supply transmission also. Around 30% of the water is wasted from the source to consumer level. In between the pipelines are broken, so around 30% of the water is lost in the transmission. And also at the consumer level, the water wastage is high because we are not using environment friendly, or we are not using the our faucets that can save the water automatically. Like we can keep taps running like that. And last I want to discuss is increasing the block pricing. If we impose higher bills for higher consumption of water, definitely there will be less wastage of water, and that can lead to the conservation of water at the consumer level. So now we discuss about the rainwater harvesting. Rainwater harvesting this technique is increasing the recharge of groundwater by capturing the and storing the rainwater. Basically, it's a simple concept. Most of the houses in Kashmir, they have what we call in Kashmir parnal, that collects the rooftop water, and through the pipe it goes to the drains or just to the ground. So in that case, we only have to add a tank underground where the drain water is stored, and that can be used for any purpose. So if we maintain that regularly, we can use it for drinking also, or only some using some treatment process. So the objectives of the rainwater harvesting, it is to reduce the runoff when we store the water in the cells, in the tanks or in the ground. Definitely there is a reduction in the runoff. It can lead to avoiding the floods. We can avoid floods, flash floods, storm water that usually we can see in rainy season on the roads. And it also can be increasing the needs of demand, increasing demands, in which the water demands can be, like in summers when the demand for water is really high. If we store the water, we can use that in peak season. It recharges the groundwater, and also it reduces the groundwater contamination. So there are various methods of rainwater harvesting, at least in the macro level or catchment, micro level or catchment level. First of all, we will discuss about the micro catchment. It can be done on farm or rooftop. what I was discussing before, that was a rooftop system where individual household can store the water underground. Next is the farm, on-farm system, where a farmer can do various interventions on this farm to save the water. First of concrete, making the circles on the steep slopes so that the water gets much time to percolate in the soil, making small pits like rock dams where the water can be stored, and runoff strips so that water can, the speed of water can be decreased and will increase the chance of water to be percolated in the soil. Next is the macro level at catchment level. It has two systems. One is wadi-bed system, another is off-wadi-bed system. Wadi is basically an Arabic term which we mean in Urdu also, a valley. So they also, on the large scale, can do the interventions. First, a small farm reservoir, so you can make the rain harvesting structures. That was one of the projects of National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, NABARD. They have created many water harvesting ponds in the various villages where the water can be saved. Wadi bed cultivation can create small paths around that where the water is, where the cultivation is done, where the water storage is done. Gesso is basically done at the higher elevations where the catchment is located, creating small dams and storing the water in there. And off-bed water system is just water spreading. Let water spread over the surface and percolates into the water, into the soil. Tanks system, it's basically available in the southern part of India. So these were the main I have briefly discussed about the methods of rainwater harvesting. So the rainwater harvesting can be complex or simple. First of all, if we talk about a simple household can collect the water and can store it and can use it for irrigation or another purposes. And another is the rainwater harvesting on the bigger scale, on the catchment bay or on the watershed base where the water is stored and treated, then supplied to municipal lines, and also then can be used for different purposes. In Israel, they have the three pipes in every household. First is the fresh water that is coming into the household from municipal supplies for drinking purpose. Next is the kitchen water that is treated and used for irrigation, and that is flush from the toilets. That is black water that is supplied to the outside for treatment, that comes again to the household for the irrigation purpose. So we should also incorporate the rainwater harvesting in that system so that overall households will become smart and sustainable, will be less dependent on municipal supplies. So what are the benefits of the rainwater harvesting? So it reduces our cost. If we have metered water supply, so we use less amount of municipal water, which means mainly comes with the pipelines, and definitely we will save our money. And so it can be used for washing the cars, flushing, or for irrigation purpose. So these are all benefits. Basically, we have water available at our disposal to be used. So this was a brief about the rainwater harvesting. So there is a famous quote from John Kennedy, ex-president of USA, and he says, "Anyone who can solve the problem water will be worthy of two Nobel Prizes, one for peace and one for science."